Dames en heren, dank voor uw geduld. Van harte welkom bij de 33e van de Leeuwlezing. Over revoluties gaat het vandaag. Over revoluties van lang geleden en over revoluties die nu gaande zijn. Over revoluties duizenden kilometers hier vandaan. Over revoluties aan onze grenzen en misschien wel binnen onze grenzen. We zullen over die revoluties horen vanuit het perspectief van een historicus, maar ook dat van een historicus en een ervaringsdeskundige. Vanmiddag zal er geput worden uit archieven, maar ook uit herinneringen. Ik verwelkom om te beginnen Russell Shorto. Mr. Shorto, in a few moments you will find yourself on the very spot where the Van der Leeuw lecture started 33 years ago with a lecture by Barbara Tuchman, a writer, historian like yourself. And we feel privileged to have you as our guest. U verstaat, spreekt en leest uitstekend Nederlands, zodat we in het Nederlands kunnen vervolgen. Hartelijk welkom ook aan professor Hans Renner en zijn vrouw Justa. Niet iedereen hier in de kerk komt uit Groningen, maar als dat wel het geval is, kunt u Hans Renner bijna niet kennen. Hij heeft een lange staat van dienst, niet alleen aan onze universiteit, maar ook in het Groninger culturele leven. We verwelkomen ook de familie van professor Gerardus van der Leeuw en de vertegenwoordigers van stad, provincie, Groningen. Voor burgemeester Den Oudsten is het de eerste keer. We hopen u hier nog vele malen te zien. Voor commissaris Van den Berg is het de laatste maal, althans in functie. Maar ook u hopen we nog vaak hier te verwelkomen. Verder verwelkomen we de vertegenwoordiger van de Rijksuniversiteit Groningen, de Hanze Hogeschool, het UMCG, de Volkskrant, Boekhandel van der Velde en de Stichting Martinikerk Groningen. In het bijzonder danken wij de donateurs van onze stichting, Studium Generale en het congresbureau van Jitty Jaarsma. Nog enkele punten van orde. De beeldregistratie van deze lezing, de teksten van de hoofdlezing, het co-referaat en het interview van Martin Sommer met Russell Shorto zullen in de loop van het weekend op de site van de vandeleeuwlezing.nl verschijnen. En morgen publiceert de Volkskrant beide lezingen in verkorte vorm. Na afloop van de lezingen zal Russell Shorto voor u rechtsachter in de kerk zijn werk signeren bij de boekentafel die is ingericht door Boekhandel van der Velde. In de pauze tussen de voordrachten kunt u zich in het koor hier achter mij iets te drinken laten inschenken. Mag ik u tot slot verzoeken uw mobieltjes uit te zetten? Dames en heren, soms lijkt het meest geïnspireerde werk over de geschiedenis van ons eigen land geschreven te zijn door niet-Nederlanders. Dat geldt voor Simon Sharma, die hier in 1989 te gast was. En dat geldt ook voor Jonathan Israel, die hier in 1998 was. Ook in dit opzicht staat Russell Shorto in een mooie traditie. Hij schreef een vervoerende geschiedenis van Amsterdam, maar ook over het Nederlandse aandeel in de geschiedenis van wat ooit Nieuw-Amsterdam was. Het is maar een klein deel van een heel groot oeuvre. Hij is het soort schrijver voor wie het leven een reis is van het ene naar het volgende boek, en voor het schrijven overigens ook daadwerkelijk veel reist. Vandaag spreekt hij over de Amerikaanse revolutie. Op het oog ver weg en lang geleden. In werkelijkheid zal blijken nauw verbonden met vraagstukken waar we vandaag de dag zo hard en zo goed mogelijk over moeten nadenken. Dames en heren, Russell Shorto.
Shall I remove my jacket? Dankjewel, professor Dreisma, voor de mooie woorden. En hartelijk dank aan het bestuur van de Van der Leeuw lezing voor de uitnodiging om te spreken. I'm very aware of this illustrious list of previous speakers, and I'm very honored to be here. Revolution is my theme. Revolution is in the air. There are many parts of the world where society is convulsed by strife and disorder. And I think it's probably natural in such instances for people who live in more settled lands to wonder about their own stress points, where issues, particularly now in Europe, with influx of refugees, issues that cause temperatures to rise, it's natural to wonder about how far can things go? When does a break happen? In my own country, the topic of revolution has been in the air in different contexts. I've been researching a book about the American Revolution, and I've been struck by how present it is in American discourse 230-odd years after the fact. In case you had not noticed, there is a presidential race going on in America, and many of the candidates seem to want a revolution, or else a return to that revolution. On the Democratic side, you have Senator Bernie Sanders, the so-called socialist in the race, though I'm not sure how many actual socialist proposals he has, and he has been calling for a revolution. Other Democrats have backed away from his use of the term. It seems possible that the undoing of the structural inequalities in the banking and financial systems, as Sanders wants, would require an actual political revolution. And those inequalities have become so vast that perhaps we are heading in that direction. On the Republican side, meanwhile, the right wing has consistently used the term. In fact, the adoption of the name Tea Party by that far-right group is an overt linkage to the American Revolution. Commentators asked, when the Tea Party came to prominence, is this the start of a new American Revolution? The group's muddled historical leanings can be pushed aside, I think, with a simple observation. All of its angry rhetoric boils down to a clarion call borrowed from the American Revolution, taxation without representation, because Britain, 230-odd years ago, was imposing taxes on the American colonists without giving those colonists a say either in the taxation or in the manner in which the monies were raised. The modern right-wing so-called revolutionaries try to apply this to politics today, to Obamacare, for example. It doesn't apply, and for a simple reason. The politicians at whom they fling the taxation without representation charge were in fact elected. President Obama, the members of Congress who supported his health care initiative, were elected representatives. Any taxation, therefore, involved representation. End of revolution, one might say. But that simple dismissal doesn't do away with the anger and fury underlying this impulse to revolt. What's happening in the Republican Party right now, the chaos, the preference for non-politicians, for non-thinkers, you might say, the righteous denial of the authority of the president, of the Congress, of the laws, seems, again, to point to some future cataclysm in America. Could it be a revolution? Answering that question is beyond the scope of this talk, I am very relieved to say. I have, however, found myself pondering the concept of revolution and what it involves. Does a sustained, violent attack against the existing order constitute a revolution? I think, for example, of something that is called Pontiac's War, which took place a decade before the American Revolution. It was a deep, coordinated, violent assault. It covered a staggering geographic territory, from the Mississippi River in the middle of the North American continent to Canada to the eastern seaboard. It involved at least 14 American tribes speaking many different languages. Thousands were killed. It was an attack on a system, on a government, on a way of life. Just for some background, Pontiac's war followed from the Seven Years' War, which in the American sphere was known as the French and Indian War. This was a contest between England and France for control of the North American continent. Before and during the war, power was balanced. The English and their American colonists were on the East Coast. The great Iroquois Confederacy occupied the area from there across upstate New York to the Great Lakes. And the French had their territory down the Mississippi River. When the English won in 1763, it upset this balance. During the war, the English had promised the Indians, had signed a treaty promising that they would never move westward from the Allegheny Mountains. After their victory over the French, they promptly took over French posts and settlements in the West. The Indians realized the English wouldn't rest in their land grabs until there was no more Western land to grab. So they began a series of attacks that spread across 30,000 square kilometers of territory over 3 years under the token leadership of an Ottawa chief named Pontiac, and with names of players and antecedents that read like a used car lot in the 1950s, Pontiac, Cadillac, LaSalle, DeSoto. Americans have a way of turning everything into advertising. I thought of that, and then I thought of the tobacco brand, Peter Stuyvesant, and I thought, well, the Dutch can do that as well. This Indian War was valiant. It was principled. They were truly in the right. It was well-reasoned. It was sustained. But it was crushed. So it was only a rebellion, not a revolution. Had it been a revolution, I would probably be speaking a variant of Iroquois right now. But it was a kind of precursor to a successful revolution, the American Revolution. I recently learned of an event that may be the Dutch equivalent of Pontiac's rebellion. That is to say, a precursor to the Dutch revolt against Spain, the so-called Arumer Zwarte Hoop Rebellion in Friesland, which tried to overthrow Habsburg rule in the early 1500s. It too failed. Perhaps it was premature. The Dutch provinces were disparate, each with its own concerns. There was no force strong enough to unite them, to make them see themselves not as Frisians first, or Hollanders, or Zeelanders, but as Dutchmen with a common purpose. In short, the ingredients were not assembled. That time came, of course. And when it came, the result was an event that changed the course of history. And here, perhaps, is an ingredient to a revolution that, if not strictly necessary, certainly brings it to our attention. Its consequences, what came of it, what resulted, what flowed from the Dutch Revolt, the Dutch Golden Age, the Dutch Enlightenment, precursor to the wider European Enlightenment, the beginnings of secularism, of scientific inquiry, true and meaningful experiments in democracy. Which brings me to my focus today, the American Revolution and its causes and influences. The American Founding Fathers showed awareness of the Dutch Revolt and looked to it as a precedent. John Adams, one of the revolutionaries who became the second president, said this, comparing the American and the Dutch revolutions. "The originals of the two republics are so much alike that history of one seems but a transcript from that of the other, so that every Dutchman instructed in the subject must pronounce the American Revolution just and necessary, or pass a censure upon the greatest actions of his immortal ancestors. Now, I should add that at the time, Adams was in the Netherlands trying to get Dutch banks to give him loans to fund the American Revolution, so he was buttering them up. But still, it shows an awareness. But my broader goal today is to gently pry at a certain scholarly dichotomy on the question of where the American Revolution came from. In recent decades, there have been two schools of thought in understanding the origins of the American Revolution. One is a variant of the so-called great man theory. It holds that revolutionary ideas germinated in the minds of an elite, leaders who were influenced by Enlightenment thinkers in Europe. This was the prevailing model of thought from the 19th century. It has enjoyed a comeback of sorts with historians and writers like Joseph Ellis, Ron Chernow, and Walter Isaacson focusing attention on the founding fathers, Washington, Franklin, Jefferson, Madison. The other school of thought grew out of the social unrest of the 1960s. It takes a bottom-up approach and holds that the impetus for the revolution came from unrest among tenant farmers, city dwellers, religious revivalists, and the like. The historian Gary Nash is often thought of as the godfather of this approach. Recent writers who have adopted it in part include Jill Lepore and Benjamin Karp. The two perspectives sometimes seem to have been in competition. Arguments have been vehement and can take modern political overtones. Are they reconcilable? Surely something as complex as a political revolution springs from many sources. What I'm going to do with the rest of my talk is outline a modest attempt to draw the two strands together by focusing attention on one largely unheralded figure from the period, while at the same time giving some special attention to the Dutch antecedent. The man I'm going to talk about, I would guess, is unknown to most, if not all of you. His name was Abraham Yates. He was born in 1724 in Albany, New York, about 250 kilometers north of Manhattan on the Hudson River. In the previous century, Albany was called Beverwijk. It was the second city of the Dutch colony of New Nederland. New Netherland had been settled by the Dutch West Indies Company following the charting of the region by Henry Hudson, who was English but sailed on behalf of the Dutch. The English took over the colony in 1664, but the mix of people, mostly Dutch, up in this northern wilderness region largely remained. It had become, by Yeats's time, something of a tradition in Albany for English men in the town to marry Dutch women. Yeats's father, Christoffel Yeats, was of English-Dutch ancestry. His mother, Catalina, was Dutch. On his father's side, his people came from Gelderland and Utrecht. Ancestors of his mother, whose name was Catalijntje Winne, came from Ghent and from Turnhout in modern-day Belgium, of course. Albany itself was a very Dutch place at this time. There were gables on the houses, koekjes for the children, Delft tiles around the hearths. People who visited said it had an isolated retro feel. It was truly a bilingual city, or rather trilingual. A visitor from another colony in 1754 remarked, "Everyone in Albany speaks Indian," by which he meant the Mohawk language. Abraham Yeats's father was a blacksmith, but the trade wasn't open to him. He was born in the city's second ward. He was the ninth child, his four older brothers took up positions at the smith, and he, however, apprenticed as a shoemaker. Apprenticeship was long, typically 4 to 7 years, and he was industrious, so he did his time and eventually went into business for himself. He kept careful books in English or Dutch, depending on the preferred language of the client. His account book, which still exists in the archive of the New York State Library, gives a fascinating look at this thoroughly Dutch-English moment in American history. It covers decades. Apparently, it was Yeats's practice to go over an entry directly with his client. So to the family of Jacob Gerritse van Schaick, who lived in the farming community of Half Moon along the Hudson River, he recorded selling 1 paar schoenen voor je kind, while to the local hatter he sold 1 stuk sol leer and had 1 paar schoenen gelapt voor je dochter. But Yeats was not content to be a tradesman. He wanted to get ahead. He made a good marriage to Annetje de Ridder, daughter of a wealthy Dutch farmer in the nearby community of Schaticook. Now that he was properly set up with a wife and a home, he took a careful look at his city and how it was changing. He was searching for a rung, for something to pull himself up. He knew that the fur trade, which had been the power base in the town, was diminishing. Albany was losing its preeminence. At the same time, it was becoming a center for tradesmen and craftsmen like him. The region was growing fast, and these men, coopers, tanners, masons, tinsmiths, who came from New York City or from Europe, saw opportunity in supplying manufactured goods to the surrounding communities. Yeats also knew that farmers in the Hudson Valley were growing wheat that was shipped to the Caribbean to feed slaves, and that the returning ships brought rum, molasses, and sugar. He decided to augment his shoe trade by expanding into the buying and selling of these Caribbean goods. And in time, he added others. He added tea, wine, writing paper. On one occasion, on behalf of his older brother, Johannes, he purchased from a Mr. Koeman de neger, de negerin, en het kind. But beyond this extraordinary transaction, he seems to have dealt exclusively in food and household items. He made profits as a merchant, but he was after something more. As he built up his trade, and as he and other tradesmen grew impatient at the rule of the leading families of the region, he was also building connections with this new working class. As was the case elsewhere, politics was a gentleman's business. In Albany, political offices were held or controlled by the extremely powerful leading families, all of them of Dutch descent. Whether he was born with a chip on his shoulder or it developed over time, Abraham Yeats did not take the inequality of Albany society as a given. A lively resentment toward the oligarchs and the special status that came with their wealth brewed inside him. He discovered that he had a preference for what he called the middle sort of people. It had long been the custom in English North America, as well as in the Dutch regions, for voters to follow the advice of their betters in deciding who to support in office. But things were changing. The Tradesmen's Guild were pushing for power, and Yeats hit on the idea of tapping into that. So in September of 1753, he ran for a low political office and won. It was the lowest office on the city council, but it was a foothold on the body that governed the city. He marketed himself directly to voters, which was something highly unusual. Those in his district were all tradesmen. They supported him. From there, he looked for more openings to exploit. He had had no higher education, but he was determined to teach himself. The next year he found another opening and became sheriff of Albany County. The French and Indian War was on at this time, with the Americans, British, and their Indian allies pitted against the French and their native allies. But as sheriff, Yeats found that his immediate enemy was not the French, but in fact the British Army, which was supposed to protect American civilians. Albany had become a base for the soldiers. Thousands were quartered in the city as part of an effort to take Canada from the French. The soldiers caused chaos. Homes were broken into, family objects taken, women were sexually assaulted. Yeats considered himself the defender of his people, and he complained to the Earl of Loudoun, the head of the British Army in North America. Loudoun rebuffed him and belittled his civil authority. Yeats then wrote to the governor. Loudoun subsequently encountered Yeats on the street, and the two had a remarkable public confrontation. Loudoun said that he had seen the letter Yeats sent to the governor complaining about him, and that it was filled with lies. Yeats replied that every sentence could be proved. Loudoun warned Yeats against discharging a military prisoner from his jail. "Sir," Yeats replied, "I have already discharged him." "By whose order?" "By the king's writ." Loudoun then ordered the sheriff to stay daily within his sight, "and if you do not, I shall send for you with a file of muskets with their bayonets fixed." The citizens of Albany, who were the witness to this exchange, must have thought that it would be the end of it. Instead, however, the inexperienced and not terribly threatening-looking sheriff replied, "My lord, I have no time to wait upon you. I have other business to attend." Loudoun, barely able to contain his fury, vowed that for Yeats's insolence he would turn his household into a hospital for wounded soldiers and the local church into an artillery storehouse. "I don't know what you will do, my lord," Yeats said, "but I know you have no right to do it." At that, Loudoun informed him that he did indeed have the right. The Lord Chancellor of England had decreed that when the army was required to defend a place, there the law ceased. Apparently in direct response to the insolence Yeats exhibited, one of Loudoun's officers afterward arrived at Yeats's house and announced that he would be staying there henceforth. There were soldiers staying in houses throughout the town. Yeats told him his house was already full of soldiers. The captain replied that if necessary, he would, quote, "lay in the same bed with Yeats and his wife." Yeats's wife was pregnant, and she shortly thereafter had a miscarriage. Now, during all this time, Yeats had been teaching himself the law. In this, he had the help of a man named William Livingston. Livingston was from Albany, but had moved to New York City. There, he had founded, as a lawyer, a journal of radical ideas called the Independent Reflector. Probably with his help, Yeats composed a remarkable memorandum against Loudoun. Now you have to remember, this is the 1750s. It's 20 years before the American Revolution. And referencing my theme of whether it was simply elites who were cognizant of these Enlightenment ideas from Europe, if they were the ones who brought about the American Revolution. Here we have a Dutch-American self-taught shoemaker who's confronting the most powerful man in America, the head of the British Army, using Enlightenment ideas of people like John Locke. He began with a basic observation that every person has, and I'm quoting him here, a fixed fundamental right born with him as to freedom of his person and property in his estate, which he cannot be deprived of. He asserted that the King of England can neither change laws without the consent of his subjects, nor yet change them with imposition against their wills. For a king is made and ordained for the defense of the law of his subjects. Then, picking up on Loudoun's pronouncements that the actions of the army in Albany transcended civil law, he declared, "The pretended power of dispensing with laws or the execution as it hath been assumed and exercised of late is illegal." He later outlined abuses that the people of Albany had endured at the hands of British troops. The most iniquitous and tyrannical violations, robberies, assault, batteries, burglaries, other most abominable crimes have been committed. He detailed how oppressive numbers of soldiers were quartered in homes. He charged that, quote, we have been threatened by the Earl of Loudoun, that our houses should be burned, that troops did indeed burn the houses. He charged that violence of soldiers had been, quote, the means of frequent abortions, that drunken soldiers have kept whores in their rooms in defiance of the people, that soldiers had stripped women naked to their waist and banished them out of the city with halters about their necks. Among the authorities that Yeats cited was John Locke, the Englishman whose two treatises of government, written the previous century, had been important for the development of Livingston's thinking. In particular, Locke's concept of natural law, according to which all people had certain basic rights that could not be taken away, inspired him. Now, you have to keep in mind also, very few people in America had read John Locke, who would become a mainstay for the revolutionary generation. But here is the shoemaker, Abraham Yeats, who finds his ideas to be suddenly pertinent to the situation that Americans found themselves in vis-a-vis the British. He referred to Locke in saying that when a government takes advantage of extraordinary circumstances to override basic rights of its people, that government becomes the product of force and violence. The presence of English soldiers in Albany during the French and Indian War helped remove, it had two effects. One, on the one hand, it helped remove a layer of the city's Dutchness that had been there from the time when it was Beverwijk. Because what happened was, with this wave of English soldiers coming into the town, they brought this fresh air they spoke with the current phrases then fashionable in London, and suddenly the English language among the young people in the town became fashionable, and Dutch began to seem old-fashioned. English was new. English was the future. At the same time, the war brought the beginnings of a split with England. Before, Americans had thought of themselves as English citizens who happened to live across the ocean, and they thought that the British thought of them that way too. The war, however, gave them the clear sense that they were considered second-class citizens, or worse, and Yeats was at the forefront of this. In the 1770s, then, he became one of the first people in the city, one of the first people in the colonies, to call for independence. He became the chairman of the Albany Committee for Correspondence, which was the shadow government during the Revolution that existed all through the colonies, and a member of the New York Provisional Congress. As of July 1776, the British colonies in North America were fighting a war against the home country. In the midst of it, of course, nobody could call it a revolution. No one knew if it would end as Pontiac's war had, if it would be crushed and be remembered by history as a mere rebellion. But with the Treaty of Paris, signed in September 1783, the colonies won a profound victory, one that would change their continent, and I don't think it is hyperbolic to say would change the world. And Abraham Yeats was part of all of this. He was a revolutionary during the war, a radical, a man living in fear of being caught and hanged. And then with the peace, he was one of the victors with the task of forming a new government. But then he made a turn that may seem surprising. The original form of government chosen by the victorious Americans was a confederation with a weak central government. There's an interesting parallel with the Dutch situation two centuries earlier. In America, people thought of themselves not especially as Americans, but as Virginians or Pennsylvanians or New Yorkers. Just as in the Netherlands, people thought of themselves as Hollanders or Frisians rather than as Dutch. And in both cases, this separateness was an impediment to unifying. to fighting a war of independence. And after the war in America, there was still a strong element of it, which is reflected in the name that they chose for their new country, the United States of America, the idea that these states individually had autonomy. After the individual colonies became states, each state kept and jealously guarded its broad powers. Each state had its own authority to raise an army, to print a currency. The national government had no president, no central leader, and it had difficulty doing things like negotiating treaties with foreign powers. Most leaders felt that this situation had to change. There was a movement to create a constitution, which would empower a new federal government that would have a degree of authority over the state governments. Abraham Yates became one of the most strident voices arguing against the wisdom of this federal government. One of those who saw that as power gathered in the hands of a small group, the federal government would take on absolute powers. He warned the delegates to the Constitutional Convention that their action would, quote, sign the death warrant of American liberty. He believed that individual liberty was best maintained by keeping power in small states, not in one large federal government. The state constitutions, he said, administered upon Republican principles are the greatest blessings we enjoy. And he added that a national constitution would be, quote, the greatest curse. In a word, he said, the new constitution will prove finally to dissolve all power of the several state legislatures and destroy the rights and liberties of the people. The interesting thing in all of this is that it sounds very familiar to those tuned into American politics today. Yates here sounds like a member of the far-right Tea Party. The irony is that this same faction believes itself to be steadfast in defending the very constitution that Yates was opposing. In fact, their rhetoric, their demands, hearken not so much to the Constitution as to the American Bill of Rights. One of the Tea Party groups on its website highlights this commitment not to the Constitution, but to these individual rights. And this is what it says on the website, Tea Party patriots stand for the right of all individuals as laid out in the First Amendment. The Bill of Rights is a fundamental piece in securing our freedoms, and every American possesses the right to free speech, the freedom of religion, freedom of the press, the right to peaceably assemble, and of course, the right to bear arms. These things still resonate with many headlines that come out of America. These are still very much prevalent in American thought, how much power should be held in the federal government and how much in individuals and individual states. Yates made this argument against a federal government to George Washington, to Thomas Jefferson, to James Madison, to Alexander Hamilton, who was the great proponent of a federal system. They all hated him. Hamilton called him a man whose ignorance and perverseness are only surpassed by his pertinacity and conceit. Hamilton said he hates all high flyers, which is an appellation he gives to men of genius. And then Hamilton revealed his own elitism when he flung another slur at Yates. Yates, he said, was a mere shoemaker. The Constitution did, of course, go into effect. Yates went on to become mayor of Albany in 1790, and he remained in that office until his death in 1796. He represents a fascinating working-class type determined to lift himself up, who remained true to his roots and to the common man, distrustful of all power and elites. But he represents something more, I think. To what extent was Yates's own very distinctive take on independence, on revolution, on the rights of the common man, a result of his Dutch heritage? We get some answer to this question from Yeats himself. For Yeats wrote, he wrote thousands of pages of material, newspaper articles, essays, political diatribes. One of the most fascinating documents he wrote is a kind of history of New York, which is in part what is surely one of the earliest histories of the Dutch colony of New Netherland. I think it was probably written in 1776 or 1777, at the beginning of the war, possibly to justify American independence by showing that the English never had claim to the land in the first place. And this document links the American situation to that of the Dutch in the clearest terms. Yeats wrote of the first settlers of the state of New York, quote, that they were Dutchmen and brought with them their history, their character, rights, liberties, their oppressors, and revolt. In other words, he said, there were Dutch here first, starting in the early 1600s, and their whole history came with them. He wrote that they had come from what he called, not at the time, people would have said the United Provinces, referring to the Dutch government, the Dutch country, but he called it the Seven United States. And he said, the United States, before their union, were made part of the 17 provinces of the Netherlands, whose respective governments were republican. They revolted, he said, because of, quote, the violation of the people's rights and liberties. He recounted the history of the Burgundian and Habsburg rulers. He devoted attention to King Philip of Spain, the zealot whose favorite instrument was the Spanish Inquisition. He wrote of the Dutch revolt and of the founding of the colony of New Netherland by this new nation. And he detailed how the Dutch in America had negotiated land treaties with the five nations of the Iroquois Confederacy. He seems in this document to have been trying to show his fellow revolutionaries not only that the Dutch Republic was a worthy model for their actions, but that the Dutch nation's claim to the territory in America constituted a wholly different legal basis for the revolution. He offers, in other words, depth to our understanding of the antecedents of the American Revolution. It was not one group of Englishmen fighting another group of Englishmen. The colonials were of mixed ancestry, and their influences were likewise more varied than we have been led to believe. Now, let me restate what I've been trying to do with Mr. Abraham Yeats. In recent years, historians of the American Revolution have divided themselves into two groups. Those who feel that the spark for the revolution was the work of the elites, and those who believe it came from the lower classes. In Yeats, we have someone who bridges that divide, a man of humble beginnings, who trains himself in the law and in these new Enlightenment ideas. And in addition, he uses his Dutch past, his knowledge of the Dutch language and Dutch history, connecting the Dutch spirit of individualism with its emphasis on individual rights, which came out of history, the battles against water, the formation of water boards, and out of intellectual history, out of Descartes and Spinoza and the Dutch Golden Age, which animated the revolt against Spain and animated the Republic under Johan de Witt. Yeats used his simmering low-class sense of injustice and his awareness of the history of the Dutch Revolt to bring a voice to the wider American debate that fueled the fires of the Revolution. And while he was not a founding father and is largely forgotten, he corresponded with, traded barbs with, and got the attention of, and surely influenced, Washington and Hamilton and Adams and the others. In one of his attempts to vilify Yeats, who won a succession of local political offices in his lifetime, Alexander Hamilton said, quote, the people have been a long time in the habit of choosing him in different offices, as if it's a negative thing for a politician to be popular. Hamilton accused Yeats of being, quote, a preacher to their taste meaning, of course, being one of them, a commoner. Again, Hamilton sees this as a negative. The truth is that Hamilton, like Washington and Jefferson, despite the vaunted nature of the American Revolution, were elitists all, who viewed common people with suspicion. This contrasts with Yeats and has everything to do with their feelings about him. Yeats was a small man, physically, to judge by the one painting we have of him, but also in terms of how he identified. He worked in politics all his life, but always at the local level. He had no patience for kings or autocrats, nor for elites of any kind. His was an egalitarian spirit. And here as well, he is reflecting Dutch history. The Dutch Republic was an utter anomaly in 17th century Europe, which otherwise was the era of outsized monarchs, from Queen Elizabeth to Louis XIV. This difference was reflected in cityscapes. In Paris and London, the skyline was dominated by cathedrals and castles, the edifices enunciating the power and might of church and state. But in the Dutch cities, the distinguishing landmarks, canals and canal houses, were lower to the ground and reflected the exaltation of ordinary life. As Romain de Hoogh, the Dutch artist and anti-monarchic writer, put it two generations before Yeats, contrasting the Netherlands with other parts of Europe, "Glory in other lands reposes in an outward show of flags, but here in the manner of thrifty and modest households." When Abraham Yeats used the term the middle sort to refer to someone, he didn't mean it as an insult, but as sturdy praise. And this, too, I think, reveals his Dutch roots. Thank you all very much for your attention.
Russell Shorto, heel hartelijk dank voor een prachtige bijdrage. Wie onder u 2 jaar geleden bij de Van der Leeuw-lezing was, zal sommige thema's bekend zijn voorgekomen. Hoeveel individuele staten op moeten geven ten gunste van een federatie. Dat is eigenlijk het leidende thema van Guy Verhofstadt en van Shaila Sital Singh. Het is duidelijk, Yeats was geen vroege Verhofstadt en andersom ook niet. Maar heel veel van de thema's die in hun beide werk een rol speelt, die komen ons buitengewoon bekend voor. Dames en heren, het is nu pauze. Na de pauze gaan we verder met de bijdrage van Hans Renner. Tot zo.